Asato ma sadgamaya, tamaso ma jyotirgamaya, mrityor ma amritam gamaya, avir avir maeti, rudrayate dakshinam mukham, tenamam pahi nityam, tenamam pahi nityam. Om shanti shanti shanti. Lead us from the unreal to the real. Lead us from darkness to light. Lead us from death to immortality. O Lord, light us through and through, and guide us evermore with thy loving presence. Om, peace, peace, peace. Well, I'm excited today because today I want to share an experience with you. An experience about a pilgrimage that I went on to Kailas. But instead of talking about this external pilgrimage that I talked about maybe a few years ago and showed you slides, I want to talk about the internal pilgrimage. How does taking any journey change us? How does it transform us? How does walking Kailas, for me, how does that help you in your experience of walking life? I read an article just a few days ago. It said that we were in an industrial revolution age, and then it went to an informational age, then into a digital age, and now we're in the millennial age where it's an experiential age. So today I'm going to share with you some of my experiences, and I'm hoping in this experiential age that you can participate, because we have some exercises for you to do. And as I'm talking, we want to see what comes up in you. What is the Divine Mother talking to you today about your journey, about your pilgrimage coming here to the Hollywood Temple? What does she want you to learn today? First question I have is, how many people, by show of hands, have gone on a pilgrimage? Okay. Anybody to Kailas? Okay, so a couple people. Very good. Well, let me start off by quickly, I'm going to show you some photographs within 5 minutes to give you sort of a little bit of a glimpse of what the journey to Mount Kailas was like. Okay. Okay. So, as you see, when you go to someplace like Mount Kailas, it is what is called the grand pilgrimage. You'll land in a place called Kathmandu, which is in Nepal, and first you'll get the you'll ask for the darshan of the Pashupata temple, and you'll see the five-faced Shiva Linga. And what we do here is traditional to ask for his blessings. And then part of the things before you get to Kailas is you have to acclimatize yourself, because it's in an altitude of between 16 to 18,000 feet. So here you'll see we're at a place called Nagarkot, 7,300 feet. And you'll see the peaks of the Himalayan range here. This is a mountain called Gori Mountain. And you'll take nature walks. There's a Swami in between here, Swami Vinayakananda. Who I went with. And when you go on any pilgrimage, one of the important things to do is the company you go with. In any journey, when you travel, one of the things you'll find out is when you travel is you get to know people. And If you're in a relationship and you really want to get to know this person, travel with them. Because in traveling, you get into unexpected situations where you just react and you get to know the person you're with and they'll get to know you. So in a pilgrimage today, when we take this, the purpose of the pilgrimage is to get to know ourselves. So here you'll find out, so what happens is then from Nyalam, we're starting our way to Kailas, and you'll see here, we go on these buses, and the roads are very, very narrow, as you can see. Now you can imagine, if another bus is coming by, how narrow it is, and the cliffs go straight down. So you can imagine we were chanting the name of God quite viciously during the trip. In fact, one devotee used to told me that he told Swami, when you lecture, I don't think much about God, but when you drive, all I can do is think about God. So in any pilgrimage, in any journey, you'll come across unexpected situations. And here what happens was there was a landslide and an avalanche. And so we actually had to get off our bus, take our luggage, go across the landslide, and get onto another bus on the other side. Now, luckily for us, and with our group, there was another bus that we could get. But for many others, they weren't able to get it. And so they had to spend the night, that night on the road. Once we get into the Chinese side, we go on these 4x4 vehicles that take us for the rest of our journey. Here's a place called Nyalam at 12,500 feet. And we're on our way to Parayang. It's about a 6-day journey, 6 to 7 days to get to Mount Kailas itself. And here you'll see some of the people who live in Parayang. Here are what we call sand dunes. This is where the Eurasian landmasses collided together, raising up the Himalayan beds. And some of the ocean beds are raised, so you actually have sand dunes in this area. Here's some of the places we stay. And as you can see, it's very cold and we sleep fully clothed. Here are some of the people here. And then from Parayang, we make our way to Lake Manasarovar, which is the highest freshwater lake in the world. And as you can see, it's very beautiful. The colors change from blue to turquoise to green. It's traditional to take a bath here before you go visit Kailas and to purify yourself. Here's our first sighting of Mount Kailas. And also what's traditional to do is what's called a homofire. A homofire is a fire where we invoke the presence of God into the fire, and we're offering vilva leaves, symbolic of our attachments, our desires, of our different identifications into the fire as a way to further purify ourselves before we go and have the darshan of Kailas. Here's Mount Kailas. So as you can see, it goes up to an altitude of 22,000 feet. It's one of the very few mountains that you can actually make a parikrama around. You can circumambulate around. A parikrama means you're circumambulating with your right side facing the mountain. Here, Kailas is the embodiment of Lord Shiva. And it's why the right side? It's a way of showing our respect and reverence to Mount Kailas, to Shiva here. Now, traditionally, it's before we start our journey here, we're at Mount Kailas, there's a temple to Lord Yama. Yama is the Lord of Death. And so here we're asking Lord Yama not to take us with him, but to bless us on this journey. And here you go, and you'll start to see, we start off in groups, but little by little, we start going, and in our own, individually, we start walking in our own ways, developing our own pace. There is no noise, and it's a place where you get to deeper and deeper silence. Kailas is the embodiment of Lord Shiva. Lord Shiva symbolizes meditation, introspection, letting go, because as you go on this journey, you start to let go of different things until it's only you and Shiva. So, what I wanted you to do is just get a glimpse of what the journey was like in Mount Kailas. And the question we should ask ourselves now is, what does all of this mean to, how does all of this relate to our divine awareness? I'm going to go very quickly here and just basically talk about, in the Taittiriya Upanishads, it speaks of each of us having five different layers. We have five different type of personalities. At the core of ourselves, we are the divine, we are the Atman, we are this pure consciousness. Then there's certain different layers. I'm just gonna go very quickly. There's the ego layer, there's the mental layer, there's an emotional layer, and there's a physical layer. When the Atman, that light of consciousness, is reflected in the ego layer, we feel our own individuality. We're sentient beings. And we feel there's a sense of I am. I am. When that light of consciousness is reflected in the mind, we become aware of our ideas and our attitudes. When the consciousness is reflected in our emotional selves, we become aware of our feelings, our emotions. When the consciousness is reflected in our physical body, we become aware of our senses, the perceptions of taste, sight, smell, touch, and hearing. And when the consciousness flows out through our senses, we become aware of the world. So, in this journey, as we're making our way on this, Mount Kailas, what we're going to discover is the different dimensions of our own self. We're going to see that this face and this body is only this external terrain. And as we walk on any pilgrimage, we're going to discover the inner terrain. We're going to discover thought currents. We're going to discover our emotional whirlpools. We're going to learn how to navigate beyond all these things to get back to our pure primordial self. This is what a pilgrimage serves to do. It's to peel off the layers and get to the essential, who are we? And you'll see, when you look at any person, when you see this photograph of Ramakrishna, the one where he's specially standing, and his eyes are half closed, you see that there's a mystery behind him. There's a mystery that we don't know of. And none of us knows another person's mystery. I had a brother who's in India. And a few months ago, he had called me up and he told me he's working there. He's been there for a few years. And he was telling me that everything's nice, but sometimes you get this feeling of loneliness, that they just don't get me. They don't know me. And that can be said for each one of us. I can never know you, and you can never know me truly. And we each have a different pathway, a different way of getting back to who we are. And today's purpose, today's inner pilgrimage, is to help uncover, to help discover the layers of who we are, and to try to find some essence, try to get to who are we, really? So, what are the preparations needed before we go on any pilgrimage? What disciplines do we need to prepare for? How do we transform ourselves, our body and mind, so that we're fit for a pilgrimage? Well, in the Bible, it says, new wine, fresh skin. Once Jesus said that no one puts new wine into old wineskins. Otherwise, the skin will burst and the wine is lost. So what we end up doing is you put new wine into new skin. What's he saying here? He's saying that this divine consciousness is constantly bubbling up. It's constantly shining forth. But because of our old skin, and I'm not talking about our physical skin, I'm talking about our attitudes, our beliefs, our old desires, we are not aware of this shining light of consciousness. We've clouded our mind. We've clouded our body. We've clouded our emotions. The sun is always shining, but we're not aware of it. We have to start removing some of this cloudiness within us. Ramakrishna has said, you don't put fresh milk into a dirty container. Otherwise, that milk gets spoiled. So today, what we're going to do is we have to create a new skin, a new relationship, a new mindset, new attitudes to try and experience this fresh, effervescent divinity that's shining forth within us. The main premise today, what we're going to be looking at, is the premise that what they use in puja. Devam bhutva, devam yajet. To experience the divine, you're going to have to become divine. So, as we begin to cleanse our body, cleanse our mind, cleanse our emotion, we're going to start feeling more and more of the warmth and the radiance of that divinity. So, part of the pilgrimage today is learning how to transform our old skin into new divine skin to feel that presence. So, what can be some of the new disciplines today that we can learn to create this new skin? Well, the first thing you're going to do, it says, is that the body should be fit. The Upanishads say, Nayam Atma Bala Hi Nena Labhya, that the Atman cannot be realized by the weak. So therefore, the first discipline we should undertake is to get this body fit and strong. So, in my journey on Mount Kailas, when I was beginning it, the first thing I noticed, as I was walking, you start to become conscious of your feet. You start to see, as you're walking, how sore they become. The corns, the blisters that start to form. And the swelling. And as you start to go downhill, you start to notice how your toes are impinged on the snow, on the shoe cap, and how painful it is. And you know what you realize? That without your feet, this journey is impossible. So what do? You start to massage them, you start to bandage them, you start to keep them dry, you start to pay attention to them. And it's, you know, in our everyday lives, it's probably the one organ that we probably neglect the most. How many of us actually bother to go and soap our feet? Or do we just let the soap suds land, sort of just go down there and hope that they get in between the toes? What's our relationship with our feet? How much time do we spend on them? What the walking does is it now plunges us into our body and into our environment. We have to be very careful of what we're walking on, what we're going to step on. It plunges us into the present moment. Right here, and right here. And another thing you start to notice is that at 16 to 17,000 feet, if you walk too fast, or if you talk too much, what happens? You quickly run out of breath. So you know what it forces you to do? It forces you, for some of us, to shut up. Sometimes for the first time in our lives. So, we learn to develop a slow and rhythmic pace. You know, the word humble comes from a root, the Latin root humus. Humus means to be close to the earth. You become attentive and grounded to your own body and your environment. So can everyday walking be something that we can use in our own spiritual practices? Can it be part of developing this new skin? When I went to Belarmat, the headquarters of our Ramakrishna order, it was on one of the first things I noticed early in the morning was that not all the monks sit and meditate. There are monks that actually go around and walk around the temple. They do a walking meditation. And the reason they do it is because first, it's very early in the morning, and sometimes you're very groggy. So walking is a way to wake you up. But also, for some of us who have very turbulent minds, it can be a way of dissipating some of that energy and allowing our minds to just to relax and to get focused. And you can chant your japa or have a dialogue with the divine, but walking can be part of waking up and a spiritual practice. Now, the next thing we should ask ourselves is, when you go on any pilgrimage, what do you take? Well, as you know, as Americans, we like to cover for every eventuality. This is saying, look before you leap. We want to make sure nothing out there can't be covered by something in here, in my backpack. But as you know, we can't cover for every eventuality. And as you start to walk, what do you start to notice? You start to notice how heavy your backpack is. You start to notice that your back starts to ache, and you feel a soreness in your lower back. And you're saying, what? Why is it? What have I done? It's because you've overloaded yourself. You've packed too much. And do you know the reason why you've packed too much? Do you know the first thing that you packed into your backpack? It was fear. Fear. The first thing, you know, when I started planning this journey is I started talking to my family and my friends. And what do you think? We all have mothers. And what are mothers good at doing? They're good at telling us, do you have this? What about this? In this situation? What about in this situation? That? They start to tell you things that what you think. They start to put more fear into you. And if you start to listen to society, all you see, if you go listen to CNN or to Fox, it's nothing but more and more fear. You know, you've got terrorists, you've got to put borders, you have, you know, pretty soon, the more fear you have, the more objects you put into that backpack. And what do you realize? That there aren't enough things to cover for every eventuality. So, what you start to realize as you're walking is that you don't need half the things that you've packed. How many of us use everything that we've packed when we go on a trip? So, you start to unload. When you're at these guest houses, you start to unload the things that you find that you don't need. And you leave them at the guest houses for other people who may want to use them. We had a person, an American, on our group, and I remember in his backpack, he had hair gel, face cream, I think it was a hair dryer. We were going on a trip that didn't allow us to bathe for 8 to 9 days. Did it really matter how we looked like? So we have to ask on our physical, spiritual pilgrimage, even today, what are we carrying? And do we need it? And as you start to lighten your backpack, three things begin to happen. What are the three things? Well, first, you discover that you don't have to be such a wuss and that you can live without many of the things that you thought you needed. It's like sometimes when desires pop up in our mind and we think, oh, we need this. But if we just allow them to come and relax into the moment, they all go. The second thing that happens is you actually start to begin to use your imagination. And you start to use your creativity and you improvise in situations for things that you need. And you learn to adapt. The third thing that happens is when you need something and there is no way of getting it, that's when the magic of the divine comes. That's when you feel her grace. And maybe part of the reason why we don't experience magic in our lives, grace in our lives, is because we factored the divine out of our lives. How many of us make the divine a companion that we travel with? How many of us dialogue with the divine every day? How many of us are willing to accept what she gives to us? When we take a risk and we're prepared to trust the divine in our lives, that's when we open up to her magic. In Kailas, in this example, there are so many things that come across that were unexpected. Things that we can't prepare for. There's the avalanche. There are times when we get someplace and there are no rooms available. What do? That's when the divine grace comes in and solves these problems for you in a way that you had no way, no expectation that it would happen. Beyond anything you could have done. There's a saying, man proposes, God disposes, and then reproposes something else. We have to be willing to accept what the divine reproposes and to go along with that. And this happens when you go on any journey. And you know it's the divine because her timing is perfect. So, question. What are we being invited this Sunday in our journey coming here to let go of? Could this be part of our new skin? To clear out some of the things that we're carrying? Maybe it could begin with our wallet or our purpose or our purses. How many business cards, ID cards, how many things have we acquired and how big is it? I remember my father, his wallet would be really huge. And if you have this wallet in the back side of your pocket, you see there's a generation, it's kind of like their tilted hips. They'd be sliding one way because the wallet's so huge. Maybe it's time to let go. Maybe it's time to take an inventory to see what are we carrying. Maybe we have iPhones and we have got all these apps and they're beeping to us every time. Our family, our friends, our CNN is telling us what Donald Trump had for breakfast. Do we need to know all this information? Can we start deleting some of these apps? Instead of going from the crooked hips, I think we're going to crooked necks, because all you do is you see these people looking on their phones. Maybe it's time to do a little bit of spring cleaning and see how much lighter we feel. So, as we continued walking, we start to become accustomed to the physical environment. Our body becomes accustomed to the environment and to our feet, and we begin to adapt. And we no longer feel any pain. Now our attention begins to focus on our emotional and mental self. As you walk, there's something rhythmic, something healing that occurs. What walking does is it starts to loosen the memories, what we call samskaras, within our body and mind. When you're walking in silence for hours, memories start to come up, unsolicited, sort of like wave after wave. Tears may begin to swell up. Where are they coming from? What are they? And you start asking Kailas about your past. Regrets, hurts may have been done to you, may have hurts that you've done to others. Mistakes, griefs, sadness that you haven't had a chance to process yet. You can't escape them. They just start coming up one after one. sort of like uninvited guest. But unlike the Jehovah's Witnesses, when they ring the doorbell, you can turn off the lights and hide behind the furniture. You can't hide from these thoughts, from these memories. You have to open up to them. You have to witness them. And who knows? Maybe they're coming to say goodbye. We had a devotee, some of you know her, Clemmie. She was a longtime devotee who had passed away a few years ago. She lived to 102 and had been practicing spirituality almost her entire life. At the end of her life, a few months before she passed away, she gave me a call and she asked me, she said, Swami, I'm getting these memories from my childhood, experiences that are shocking me, that I don't like. Why, after so many years of spiritual practice, why are these disturbing thoughts coming to me? Why are they there? Have my spiritual practices all been useless? Then I told her what a Swami had told me once, a senior Swami. He said, as we get older, what happens sometimes is that the conscious mind starts to weaken and the unconscious starts to come forth. The things that we put into the basement of our mind, sort of repressing away, they start to come up. And the thing when that happens, he said, is don't be disturbed. It's like a magician bringing out the different colored scarves, red, yellow, blue. These thoughts come up one by one. But the thing he said was, let them come up, bubble forth, and then as a witness, bubble out. Come up and bubble out. Don't get agitated. So how much fear are we carrying? What have we been invited to let go of today in terms of what we're carrying physically, mentally, emotionally? Could this be what today's pilgrimage is about? To get rid of the things that we're carrying consciously or unconsciously. If I were to ask you, what are you being invited to let go of right now? What would you say? So today we're going to do an exercise. It's an exercise of learning to let go of things. What we're going to do is we're going to identify the physical, mental, and emotional disturbances within you, the problems within you, and we're going to offer them to the divine as a way of releasing them. In the fire ceremony that I told you, of the yajna fire, we invoke God's presence into the fire and offer our attachments as a way of destroying them. So today, I want you to sit quietly for a moment right now. Tune into your body and ask, what does your body want you to let go of right now? What is it that physically prevents you from staying in the present moment? Are you being invited to let go of youth and accept wrinkles and gray hair? Of letting go of trying to stay young forever? Maybe it's letting go of the energy that we had when we were 20 and expecting it to be there when we're 70. Maybe it's letting go of our own body image, that we're too fat or too skinny. In India, skin color is a big thing. Or maybe there's different features of our bodies. It could be also something right now that you feel. Maybe it's a backache, a muscle soreness. What do you want to physically let go of right now? I want you to think about it. One or two words. Once you have it in mind, we're going to offer it to the divine into this candle here, our yajna. This light here in front of us symbolizes the divine, and by offering anything into it, we're going to destroy it. So, I want you to mentally inscribe the thought of what you want to let go of physically on this piece of paper that I have right in front of me here. Okay? And we're going to chant this mantra up on the board here three times. And each time we chant the mantra, physically think of what you're letting go of. The mantra here is Om Aim Kalaya Swaha. Om here symbolizes the infinite. Aim is what we call a bija mantra, a seed syllable. It represents, symbolizes the destruction of ignorance, of ajnana. Kalaya symbolizes time. Anything physical gets destroyed in time. Swaha is an offering. So let us do this together. We're going to do it three times. Each time, we're going to offer. Think of what you want. I've written Om in this piece of paper. Mentally inscribe the physical thing you want to let go of. And three times, let's do this together. Om Aim Kalaya Swaha. Om Aim Kalaya Swaha. Om Aim Kalaya Swaha. O Divine Mother, manifesting as time, please accept our offering and let us and help us let go. Now, mentally, what have we been invited to let go of? Maybe there are attitudes that we've held on to from our folks, opinions that we're not prepared to change, judgments, prejudices. Can we let go and be prepared to find a new way of looking at life? Could this be what the Divine Mother is asking us to do? What are the thoughts right now in your mind that don't serve you? It could be thoughts that trigger negative thinking. Thoughts that come up with our critical voice, our judgmental voice. Thoughts like, nobody likes you, or you're no good at this. Thoughts that create distractions in our life. And when we hear them, like politics, race, or family, we unconsciously react. It could be like feeling disrespected. Mentally identify your negative thoughts and note them right now. You know, for me, before coming here, the thought of me having to lecture created anxiety within me. For some of us, the thought of Donald Trump becoming president creates anxiety within them. So, figure that thought out right now and let us inscribe it here on this piece of paper, which I'm going to offer. And we're going to chant three times this mantra on the board. Om Aim Ishvaraya Swaha. Ishvaraya, Ishvara, here's the cosmic intelligence. Let's do this three times. Mentally, the thought that you want to let go of that creates disturbances in you mentally. Could be family, whatever triggers you, and you start to react unconsciously. Together. Om Aim Ishvaraya Swaha. Om Aim Ishvaraya Swaha. Om Aim Ishvaraya Swaha. O Divine Mother manifesting as Ishvara, may you accept our thoughts and help us be free. And now, emotionally. What do we have to let go of emotionally? Letting go of things that are attached to our hearts. Now, for most of us, this is probably our biggest baggage. It's our heaviest load. It could be relationships that are not helpful. It could be unrealistic dreams that don't work now And as long as we hold on to them, we're not open to the dreams that await us. It could be of letting go of old loves. They've moved on, and we have to prepare ourselves for the new loves in our life. It could be letting go of old hurts and memories, because we carry those old hurts, and when we scratch them, it creates pain. Can we learn to forgive? And what you may observe is that when you think about these thoughts, there may be some physical tension in you. For me, it's the gut. Certain thoughts trigger a tension in my gut. So become aware of that. And as I loosen my gut, the thought will also diminish. It could be mistakes and embarrassing moments in our lives. We all have them. It could be the failures that we haven't forgotten about. It could also be our cultural baggage that we carried from another country into here. You know, Swami Vivekananda came to America and spoke nothing but pure Vedanta. Vedanta stripped away of its caste culture. Vedanta devoid of its kitchen culture, of its don't touch culture. So when he gave that to Americans, how much they appreciated that. And then when he went back to India from Madras to Almora, he made it a point to speak of nothing but the pure Vedanta, removing all the cultural baggage that has come along with it. So, what are you feeling right now? What is the feeling that comes up and it's not serving you now, that you want to surrender? Feel it. It may arouse shame, guilt, anger, anxiousness. Give it a name if you can. And we are going to offer this to our Ishtadevata, to the divine that we connect with emotionally. So here I'm just going to use Sri Ramakrishna. And the mantra is going to be Om Aim Sri Ramakrishnaya Swaha. So have that thought that you want to let go of emotionally. And three times, let's chant this mantra. Om Aim Sri Ramakrishnaya Swaha. Om Aim Sri Ramakrishnaya Swaha. Om Aim Sri Ramakrishnaya Swaha. O Divine Mother manifesting as Sri Ramakrishna, may you accept our emotions and help us be free. Once you start to do this, what happens? If you do this as a practice, or any mental thought that gets triggered, any emotional feeling that gets you feel, any physical pain, chanting a mantra and offering it to the divine, you start to create a space between you and that problem, between you and that thought, between you and that feeling. So that when someone, if you're driving and someone sort of flips you off in the freeway, you don't overreact. You begin to lighten the impact it has on you, the charge that it has on you. In the presence of people that may trigger us, in the presence of ideas, if we mention them, they create charged reactions. How much lighter will our load be then? It's a process here to help us cleanse, release, and stay in the present moment. You know, when I was in Kailas, I noticed that sometimes all these things were coming up, and there was a person who was bragging about how athletic they were, and I was noticing that when he was walking way ahead of me, the envious eyes started coming out. And I was thinking, oh, he's going to be the first one to reach there. He's going to brag about getting the best bed and being the first one to reach there. And sometimes I'd even look behind me and see a lot of people way behind me. And then the judgmental eye would come out and say, why can't they keep up with us? Why are they so out of shape? We have to ask ourselves again and again, with what eyes are we seeing the world through? What needs to be left behind today? What are we going to leave behind at these guest house beds once and for all? A poem by Francis Dorff really, in brief, talks about this. The first thing we have to do is to notice that we've loaded down this camel with so much baggage. We'll never get through the desert alive. Something has to go. Then we can begin to dump the 1,000 things that we've brought along until even the camel has to go. And we're walking barefoot on the desert sand. There's no telling what will happen then. But I've heard someone who's walked this way has seen a burning bush. This burning bush is our divine consciousness. So, I'm just letting you right now know this talk is going to go about 15 minutes overboard. Once you've evacuated a lot of the pain, the next thing that comes on the heel of pain is joy. And you begin to talk to Kailas about your hopes, your dreams, and your future. And suddenly, you ask Kailas, or suddenly Kailas asks you, are you walking your life? Whose life are you walking? And you wake up and you ask, am I living my life because of my partner's dreams? Or because it's what I thought my parents wanted me to do? Or what society wants me to do? Am I just doing what education tells me to do? What the church tells me to do? Am I walking my life? Have I discovered my truth, my path? And if we haven't discovered our truth, will we ever become alive? Have we lost the connection with what makes us alive? The thing that energizes us and makes us free. Do we feel energized when we wake up in the morning? Do we feel that our life is flowing and opening up? Or do we feel depressed and feel like it's stagnating? How many of us are not living because we have not been able to claim our camino, our way? Where are we in our life journey? When you look back as we've walked so forth, you look back, you can see your past. Now you're looking ahead to see what the future holds. Am I on the road to glitter? Am I on the path to peace? Where do I want to be? So, what we notice as we're walking is that as the body calms down and adjusts to the environment, our awareness, our consciousness, expands into our emotion and mind. As we silence one part of our personality, an awareness opens up into the next stage. Once the memories and emotions begin to diminish, our awareness expands into our ego, our identity. And one of the great gifts I believe that travel gives us is to be anonymous, to let go of our identity. Nobody knows me when I'm traveling. I am free to be myself and leave all my duties behind. I can finally take off the mask of my own ego. All of us play so many roles in the course of our lives. When is the last time you were able to let go of all your roles? I'm talking about the boss role, the mother role, the parent role, the Swami role, just to unbuckle and be free. You wonder sometimes how you can breathe with all these layers of masks that we're wearing. To let go of the mask and get back to our primal essential self. To be okay that, you know what, it's okay not to have all the answers. It's okay not to live up to others' expectations. Take off the hats of the ego. Let go of our identity, of all the things that support us. The doctor role, the engineering role, the president role, the CEO role, the things that give us respect and importance. They are good, but sometimes they also prevent us from experiencing the divine as well. These also have to be left behind. Can we learn to let go of our roles when it's not necessary? Say, for example, when we step out of our work environment. Do we need to introduce ourselves as the doctor so-and-so when we come into our personal lives, into our social lives? Do we need that? Because do we feel, does it give us entitlement? Does it give us respect and honor? Do we need that? There is a story in the Mahabharata about the Pandava brothers. And as you know, the Mahabharata was about a war that occurred between basically good and bad, righteousness and unrighteousness. At the end of the story, the five brothers, who after thousands of deaths, I believe only 11 survived. And so a lot of war is never good in this sense, that there was a lot of destruction. And so the brothers and their wives start to make their way back now at the end of this to the Himalayan mountains to go to heaven. And as they go, one by one, different people start to pass away in this journey. Draupadi, the wife of all the brothers, passes away first. And the oldest brother, Yudhishthira, was asked, why did Draupadi pass away? And he said, it was because of her partiality. She was partial to one of the brothers, Arjuna. Because of that, she had passed away. And then they keep walking. And then the next person to pass away was Sahadeva, one of the brothers. And then Yudhishthira was asked again, why did he pass away? It was because of his pride in wisdom. That's why he passed away. And then they keep going. And then the next person was Nakula. And again, Yudhishthira was asked, why did Nakula pass away? Because of his pride of being too handsome, vanity. And then they continue on, and Arjuna, the hero of the Bhagavad Gita, passes away. And Yudhishthira is asked again, why did Arjuna pass away? Because of his pride and skillfulness. Then, as they go, there's only two brothers left, and Bhima passes away. Why did Bhima pass away? Because of his pride and his strength and his gluttony. And finally, Yudhishthira comes to the top, and Indra, God, comes with the chariot, says, I can take you from here. And Yudhishthira all the time had a dog with him. And says, no, but the dog can't come with you. And he said, well, okay, you can't take the dog with you on this chariot, but I'm not going to let go of my dog, so forget it, then I don't need to go. The dog represented Dharma. He wouldn't let go of Dharma. But in some sense, we even have to let go of Dharma and Adharma to get to our transcendental self. The pride of being spiritual also has to be let go of. So at what stage are we in our journey? Do we hide behind our beauty? Do we hide behind our skills? Do we hide behind our spiritual bride that I am holier than thou? All these also have to be stripped away. And when you're going on this mountain in Mount Kailas, it happens. No matter how strong you are, there comes a point where you just can't go out much any longer. No matter how much beauty you have, it doesn't matter. It's not going to help you. None of these things will help you. You basically get to a point where you just break down and you surrender. And you're all you have. You don't have any supports. There's nobody there. It's just you and Shiva, you and Kailas. And that's when your true self, your true desire starts to emerge. And in that doing so, this divine grace comes into you and strength comes back. When we strip away our privileges based on money, occupation, and social standing, we find that we're all very similar, that we all belong to one human family, basically one. Also, we should ask maybe, when's the last time our feet actually touched the soil, dug into the dirt, our own dirt? Remember, Holy Mother has a saying at the end of her life. She says, "Don't find faults in others. Look at your own faults." Could this be what this physical, spiritual Camino, this pilgrimage, is inviting us to do? To take off the hats of our identity and to go inside. So the last thing here, one of the last exercise, mentally think of how you define yourself. What is it that of your identity that you're most attached to? It could be that you're a good cook. Whatever that identity is, bring it up to your awareness. And we are going to chant this mantra, Om Aim Brahmane Swaha, to Brahman, three times as a way of letting go of our identity. So bring it up to your awareness. What is it that defines you? What is it that gives you the respect, importance, or how you see yourself? And let us offer that to the divine, chanting together. Om Aim Brahmane Swaha. Om Aim Brahmane Swaha. Om Aim Brahmane Swaha. O Divine Mother, manifesting as Brahman, may we offer our identity to you and help us let go. Now, because of this, life gets reduced to a simplicity. As you start peeling the layers of your personality and stripping yourself to your core, you begin to have a different relationship with people. When I was in Kailas, you get the experience where you're in a place, you don't know anyone, you don't understand the conditions, you are vulnerable, you're in pain, and now you begin to feel that the people out there come to you, are sent by the Divine Mother to help you. You become open and receptive to what the Divine Mother brings us. If you're hungry, you don't care if it's food from a five-star hotel, or if it's yak's milk and chapatis, you just eat, because it fills your hunger. If you're on a bus that goes for 4 hours continuously and you have to go to the bathroom, once that bus opens up, you don't care if there's a bathroom or not. You just go. In fact, what you'll find as you're going on your journey, the bathrooms go from the form to the formless. You become a child in an unknown culture, in unknown circumstances, in harsh conditions, where there's no one to call on or depend on except the divine. And in that calling, what you discover is your true self emerges. Your true desires come up. Your true voice comes out. This is your inner child, your divine child, that only seeks the comfort and consolation of his or her divine mother. Simplicity here means stripping yourself to these essentials of life, so you come to the core of your being. Now, once the panic has subsided, and once you stop calling for people and things for help, what you discover is she comes and aids in mysterious ways. I remember there was a time when I went on Kailas. I did go to Kailas, but I wasn't able to complete the journey. I was able to go halfway on this parikrama, where what happened was six people in our group of about 30 got very sick. They had hypothermia. Two became so severe that they had to be rushed back. And since if going nonstop back to Kathmandu, where the nearest hospital was, would take us 3 days, we had to stop. And we had to say, we had to turn around. And so we had got back to the place where, before we get to Nepal, we're on the Chinese border. Half of us stayed with this particular person to help her travel. And I had gone with her. And my passport was with another group because I thought the passport guy, thought our tour guide had it. So I was stuck in the Chinese border. I wasn't able to enter into Nepal until the next group came there. So I was stuck there. It was late at night. And I remember went to the last hotel. There's no place to stay. And I pleaded my condition. And they just had no room. And when I finally decided, okay, I'm going to accept the condition. I'm going to go stay in this coffee house and just stay up all night. That's when somebody came up and said to me, I heard what you're saying to the hotel owner. I'm an American. I have an extra bed in my place. If you like, you can come stay with me. She works her magic when we let go of what we're expecting and we surrender into the situation. That's when she comes. The journey is a process of letting go of expectations so that you have no expectations. And whatever comes forth, it's like, this is divine grace. As you continue to walk, once the tears of sadness have passed, the tears of joy have went, the simplicity of life gets reduced to a backpack, to a road, and your walking stick, and the divine. The divine becomes the road, and that road starts to speak to you. I don't have a lot of time here now, but I will just say that in the travels, what happens also is that you may find your intuitive mind starts to awaken, a sixth sense. When you're in a place where you have to make decisions spontaneously, to know that when a taxi cab driver comes in, can I trust this guy, get in the cab, and he'll lead me to the destination, or in a glance say, no, I've got another ride. Your sixth sense has to be awakened. And when we find is when our individual mind starts to infuse into this cosmic mind. That cosmic mind may speak to us through symbols. In the biblical and Hindu tradition, they talk about symbols. Now, they talk about God in the Christian tradition speaks through us through a cloud, fire, a burning bush. Jesus has said, I am the road. I am the way, I am the door. In the Chandogya Upanishads, a young boy, Satyakama, was on a journey, and on his journey, the divine spoke to him through a cow, through a fire, through a swan, each time revealing a different part of his divine self. One Swami explained to me that when your individual will gets infused into the divine will, that divine will begins to instruct you, to guide you, to care for you, to be your GPS, your God-pointing system. It's when your rational intellect silences, surrenders, that the divine will takes over and instructs you, sometimes through symbols. So I don't have time to get into it, but we've heard many times when some of our swamis are going to Narmada on different journeys, and they're lost, and there's nobody around. All of a sudden, a young girl comes out of nowhere and points in a direction. Who this girl is, where she came from, no idea. It's impossible for her to be there. Even by looking at a rock, sometimes you come across, seeing the rock, and seeing the dents in the rock, it reminds you maybe, what are the dents in my life? And then you look closely at the rock, and you see there's moss growing in it, and you see that within the dents of your life, there's life, there's vitality. What is it that I need healing right now that's in the dents of my own life? As you walk, you start to discover that not only do the memories come up, but also the rhythmic walking begins to open up an inner gravity within you. We all have that inner divine gravity. She's pulling us, all of us, to her. But as you know, we've got so many distractions in life. Look at this, read this, Google this, Donald Trump's on this. When do we get that time to walk for 8 hours at a time in silence? The divine gravity is going to start pulling you to her, our divine consciousness, once we can get through the distractions, once we can get through the boredom. The minute we feel this pull, know that it is her longing to be with you. It's that urge for deep, still quietness. That is her trying to pull you closer. Will you resist? I remember Swami Sarvadevananda would tell us that the moment you feel the deep inclination for quietness, run to the shrine. Just go to the shrine. That's her trying to call you. The walking was pulling us down into a place inside of us that we knew of, a place that we had been to, but never to that extent. Sort of a new place, yet an old place, a familiar place, yet a completely strange place. And there's a divine gravity within each one of us that's pulling us into that sacred place. So I'm going to summarize it with this poem here by Wendell Berry. And the world cannot be discovered by a journey of miles, no matter how long, but only by a spiritual journey, a journey of 1 inch. Very arduous, humbling, and joyful, by which we arrive at the ground of our own feet and learn to be at home. He's saying, what's he saying here? That no matter how many miles we travel, it's not about out there. It's about in here, a spiritual journey, not a physical journey, a journey of 1 inch. What is that 1 inch? Well, I had some idea, and when I asked the Swami, he verified it. What is the 1 inch? The 1 inch was not the physical number of miles you walk. The 1 inch was going from your anatomical, physical heart to your spiritual heart. That distance is 1 inch. The definition of a pilgrim comes from two Latin words. I'm going to end it here. Per ager. It's from two root words. Per means beyond. Ager means field. Pilgrim is one who has the courage to go beyond their field, beyond the known into the unknown, beyond their safety and security into the mystery. When somebody asks you in this process, where are you? Where are you? You could say, I'm here in Hollywood. And they ask you, where are you really? Where are you really? Well, I'm lonely. I'm tired. I'm worried. Where are you really? What we're trying to do, what they're asking you, is that there are two Sanskrit terms. There's the field and the knower of the field. This thing is the field, the kshetra, the field. Today, we want to discover the knower of the field, kshetragya, the knower of the field. So today, as pilgrims, we've been invited to Per Ager, to go beyond the field into the knower of the field, to go beyond what we're comfortable with, what gives us safety, comfort, to start to journey out a little bit, to go into the uncomfort, and knowing that the divine is there, to take a risk. So, that's what we've been invited to do today. Any journey, any time we go, take it as a spiritual journey. And see if you can discover the many dimensions of your own self. Thank you.
Om Sahana Vavatu Sahano Bhunaktu Sahaviryam Karavavahai Tejasvi Navaditamastu Mavid Vishavahai Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.
May that infinite reality protect us. May it sustain us. May we grow strong together. May our study be vigorous and illuminating. May there be no ill will amongst us. Om, peace, peace, peace be amongst all living beings in the universe.